Naomi, I'm Corey Price. I'm the host of Creative Mornings. So just really happy that this is our second event in person and happy to have you all here. All right. So we're going to the next slide. So Creative Mornings is in 223 cities, 67 countries worldwide, with over 27,000 morning people like ourselves attending today. So many different ways to connect with Creative Mornings globally, and just wanted to give you a look at the size. Next slide. So July's theme is spirituality. Our Jana chapter chose this month, and this illustration was done by Bayan Yassin. So we always like to kind of give a spotlight to great graphic design that we get every month. So I'd like to take a moment to thank some partners, both global and local. So first is MailChimp, who is Creative Mornings' global, official global partner for marketing. In 2022, they released a benchmark report showing that 48% of freelancers said that client referrals are, far and away, the best way to bring in new clients. In the Creative Mornings email that you receive, there is a link to a referral guide that they sent. And then wanted to thank all of our local partners so much. So that's Worth Higgins & Associates, Ting, The Fralin, Willow Tree, UVA Arts, The Bridge, and New City Arts. Kristen Finn, thank you, Kristen. Right there in the back. And Jacob Cannon, so thank you, Jacob. And then thank you to Lone Light and the next slide, Baker No Bakery. Delicious donut. We get to welcome our wonderful speaker this morning. So I'll read his bio and then he'll be up here. So Ashon is a writer, artist, and teacher exploring the intersection of performance, blackness, queerness, and spirituality. Associate professor of religious studies and African American and African studies at the University of Virginia, he is author of Black Pentecostal Breath, The Aesthetics of Possibility, and The Lonely Letters. He's currently working on a book about Black social life, a book about the Hammond, B3 organ, the Black church and sexuality, and a short story collection. A McDowell Interdisciplinary Arts Fellow and a New City Arts Initiative Fellow, his work has been featured at Second Street Gallery, Welcome Gallery, Bridge Projects, and the California African American Museum. All his work is about otherwise possibility. So please join me in welcoming Ashon.
Thank you all for having me and being here this early in the morning. It's strange. I wake up just about every day, 5 in the morning, to go to hot yoga down the street. It still somehow feels early to me because I do hot yoga when I'm not awake. And it doesn't actually wake me up, it makes me more tired. But I'm really thankful to be here, thankful for the invitation. And because I have too many slides for 30 minutes, I'm gonna get started. All of my work is trying to think about concepts and questions of spirituality. And so it's always a joy to share. And I might cry because that happens a lot when I talk these days. This is a line from the book The Lonely Letters, which was published in April of 2020, so a month after we in the States were acquainted with this thing called COVID, a book was published titled The Lonely Letters, which was very, very weirdly serendipitous because of the forced isolation that we had to endure. And the book is really trying to think about the problem of forced severance of connection. And so one of the lines, which is, I think, the thesis statement of the book, and also I think the thesis statement of my art practice, and perhaps the thesis statement of my life, is everything said, everything written is in search of connection. And I think that's what spirituality is as well. It's a desire to be connected to the deep mystery of this mysterious beyond in which we live. And I get the phrase mysterious beyond from the movie Land Before Time. I watch a lot of children's programming because it's about imagination and friendship and joy. And so mostly my TV is set to cartoons. And when I leave the house, my dog will watch, what is it, Mickey Mouse Club on Disney Junior Plus? And Bluey, which took me a long time to get into, but I'm all the way into it now. It took a bit. But I'm really interested in the ways that we can be connected to one another. And so I'm gonna hopefully try to do these slides in 3 10-minute blocks, but we'll see. The first set of slides is about the way sound can carry relationship. And this first video is of a Senegalese man praying the Adhan, which is a Muslim call to prayer. Had done a lot of research on the sound of the Adhan, and when they listened to the sound of the blues in the United States, they noticed a very close intimacy with regard to both of these sonic traditions. And so praying is not singing, and I'm not trying to reduce praying to a song tradition, but if one listens to the way the blues sounds, one can get a deep sense for the relationship between the blues as a tradition and Islam as a practice. And many of the Africans that were stolen from countries in Africa and forced to labor here in the United States were from Muslim populations. A lot of them were Muslim. And so it makes sense that there is this deep resonance. And so this is a song called The Levee Camp Holler, which was recorded by Lomax at Parchman State Prison in Louisiana. Very terrible.
Lord, I woke up this morning, man, I'm feeling bad.
Well, I think hopefully you hear some of the resonance. But for me, because I grew up, very short biography, I grew up in East Orange, New Jersey. I went to public school, K-12, and my father is a pastor of a Pentecostal church, my mother is a preacher in a Pentecostal church, my brother was the musician for our church and a preacher. I was a choir director, musician, preacher, went to seminary, no longer do any of that stuff. But my life was deeply influenced by the sound of Pentecostalism. It's what my first book is about. It's kind of what my second book is about. It's definitely what the third one is going to be about. The fourth one, and the fifth one, too. And I'm not just, like, I'm writing 3 actively currently, and it's kind of terrible. But also fun. But they're all about the sound and how sound actually carries relationship. And so sound for me is one of the places where connection actually happens. And so as I was researching and thinking about the sound of the blues, one of the things that is colloquially said about the blues is that it's just gospel with different lyrics. And so if that is true in a colloquial way, then there must be a relationship between the sound of Islam and the sound that happens in Black churches too. And if one pays attention to praying in Black churches, one can get a sense for the relationship between Christian practices of prayer that Black folks do and Muslim practices of prayer that Black folks do. And so this is a call to prayer in a Baptist tradition called A Charge to Keep I Have. Notes. And so breaking that one syllable into multiple notes in order to add flourish to whatever that syllable is in a word is something that is actually carried across from Islam into the Black Christian practice of prayer as well. Also, there's this thing called the blue note, which in the blues is the blue bar, which makes it sound sad or in the minor tone. And that too is very apparent in the Adhan. It's apparent in the blues, and it's apparent in this prayer too, but it also happens in the Pentecostal tradition, the tradition in which I grew up, which the most reductive way, but also the quick way to talk about Pentecostals is they're the ones that believe in speaking in tongues as the evidence of the Holy Spirit living within one's body. And so praying in Pentecostalism also sounds similar.
Jesus, oh Jesus, close I am Jesus, oh Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Connection, interested in exploring and thinking about and thinking through connection. I do a lot of work on the Hammond organ, which is an instrument that was invented in 1935 in Evanston, Illinois. It is, if you walk into a Black church in the United States, it is very likely that you will see a Hammond organ. Black churches, I say, popularized the Hammond organ through revival services and radio programming and albums that a lot of church choirs were creating after the B3 model, which was invented in 1950. It's an instrument that gets taken up in Black social life very, very quickly. It is supposed to be portable, it's 400 pounds. It's not like a pipe organ, because a pipe organ you have to actually construct into the actual building in which it will be played. A Hammond organ is the first successfully marketed electric instrument ever created. And one of the reasons I argue the instrument is so easily taken up is because there is a way that you can change the sound of the instrument very, very instantaneously, which is actually a failure of the instrument because the inventor wanted it to be exactly like pipe organs, but cheap. But pipe organs respond to touch very slowly, whereas Hammond organs respond to touch, because they're electric, very quickly. And the failure of the instrument, because it responds too quickly, actually creates a perfect occasion for it to be used in religious spaces where things are happening very quickly. You're trying to create drama, you're trying to create intensity and movement of spirit in sound. You can do that very, very quickly with the Hammond organ. So I do a lot of research on the Hammond organ. Also, the first church that it was really sort of popularized in Chicago was First Church of Deliverance, which the pastor was gay, the assistant pastor was a lesbian. It was very, very, very well known that they were a stop on the gay nightlife circuit in Chicago in the 1930s, 40s, 50s, 60s. And they all renounced that history today. But it is very apparent that this was a very queer space, and it's also the first space that a lot of people heard the Hammond organ because of their radio broadcast, which was the second radio broadcast in Chicago, Illinois. All that to say, the Hammond organ is very, very important to Black social life. It's very important to the Black church. It's very important to Black spirituality. And it's very important to me because it's a space through which to think about queerness, the sacred, and sound all together. So I've been curating these shows with the Hammond organ since 2017. This was in 2019 at Yale University at the Institute of Sacred Music. We had two Hammond organs in the chapel. We had two people playing Hammonds. They would trade off. But before we began, I asked each of them to play like a prelude. The other person who played is a Baptist, and so she played a hymn from the Baptist tradition. This person who I'm going to play the entire video grew up in the Pentecostal tradition. His name is Abdul Hamid Robinson Royal. He grew up in the Pentecostal tradition. He converted to Islam probably about 20 years ago, practicing Muslim, but also one of the best church musicians I've ever heard, and I'm not the only one that says it. And so he still actively plays for churches. And so what he played on the Hammond was the Adhan, the Muslim call of prayer, and he had never played it before. So.
Thank you.
off there. I would say that you're not supposed to actually scream whoop during prayer, but I grew up Pentecostal. You are supposed to do that, so it's actually appropriate. And the last of these is, this is a prayer called the Talbiyah, which is prayed as people are preparing to go on Hajj in Mecca. This is in Philadelphia, which is to me a black Muslim city, and it sounds like a black Baptist call and response prayer. It's really important to me that we figure out this relationship between religious practices, because of the increased Islamophobia since 9/11 is one reason, but also because of religious chauvinism and the problems that emerge from thinking that your tradition is the only tradition or the best tradition or the tradition that corrects the problems of all the traditions that have come before it. And so for me, having grown up Pentecostal, and like what that meant was having a deep aversion for Muslims, as a young person and being very, very Islamophobic as a young person, having to unlearn that and fight against that and contend against that. And one of the ways that I actually figured out that could be done is to actually pay attention to the way things sound, because the sound is one of the things that I think connects these different practices of black spiritualities. In 2011, sorry, I'm trying to go backwards. 2011, a friend of mine sent me a video of a little girl painting. And when I saw that, I was writing these semi-autobiographical letters and sending them to myself in my email in 2010 and 2011. And I wrote a letter to a person named Moth, who doesn't exist, about a painting practice where the person who was writing the letter would take paint on their hands and clap to the rhythm of Pentecostal praise music, which is called shouting music. And that was in 2011. And Ashon didn't figure out that he should try to do this until 2017, so literally 6 years later. And so I wrote my first two books. This is an image of, this is the first attempt of me trying to do what the little girl did while listening to a Pentecostal praise break, and so you can YouTube praise break. It's a very fast tempo, very energetic, very spirited, very lively form of religious worship where you are dancing, which we call shouting, you're clapping your hands, sometimes you're crying, but there's a lot of movement that happens in shouting. And so I wanted to see what shouting would look like rhythmically by putting paint and ink on my hands. And so this was the first attempt to actually do that. I put ink on my hands and I threw water over the paper and I listened to a praise break that I found on YouTube, and this is what happened. This is another one. I'm moving quickly now. But I also wanted to see what shouting would do on paper, which is dancing rhythmically, and this is an example of shouting. And so in 2017, in my old apartment, 1600 Jefferson Park Avenue, number 2, I think, one night I had some paper, I bought some pigment powder, and I decided to put on a praise break. I had on headphones so that I could turn the music up as loud as possible. And I listened to the praise break, I poured the pigment powder on the surface, and I shouted on the surface. It was my first time doing the thing called shouting in a very, very long time. I went to seminary in 2005, and that's pretty much the last time. Right before that, I was a member, a musician, and choir director at a Pentecostal church in Chicago, in Philadelphia. I've never lived in Chicago. In Philadelphia. And that was the last church that I was an active member of for a lot of different reasons. The 2004 election happened, I got to arguments with a whole lot of people. And so, but like one thing that they knew I would do in church on Sunday is that it don't matter if he's playing an organ or the keyboard, he's gonna get off and he gonna dance, because that's what I did. And so I wanted to see what that would look like. And I used paint and I kept slipping and I said, well, I need something that's dry. And so I tried pigment powder. And so this is one of the paintings. They're 30 by 44 inches long. This is another one. This is longer, it's like 64. This is another one, also like huge. Two of them were at the African American Museum in the California African American Museum. I also took architecture courses in undergrad, and I was really moved by section drawing. And I went to Italy in 2018, saw an exhibit about Italian architecture. They showed a bunch of section drawings. And so I wanted to see what would happen if you apply section drawing principles to this praise noise, because I want to do holograms in the future. I'm just going to cycle for it. So this is another painting of me clapping to the rhythm of Pentecostal music, and then me trying to create a section drawing of that. But I'm trying to render it digitally because, again, I want to do holograms, but holograms don't exist in the way I need them to. So a friend said, try augmented reality. And so I downloaded a whole bunch of stuff on my iPad and my computer and tried to render those images through these digital tools. Real quick.
So this is what the model looks like as a three-dimensional augmented reality model. But it's pretty small.
So I'm skipping, and I blew it up.
Now this is the same image, the same model, but blown up to be a much bigger scale.
And the point is that Pentecostal sound is an immersive environment. It is not just sight, it is sound, it's sight, hearing, touch, taste, and whichever of the other ones, smell too. And so trying to use augmented reality to create an immersive environment is what the point of this was, and trying to walk through it. And so I'm doing that now, even though it's taking a lot longer, and it's much more difficult to do with the shouting pieces. I'm trying to render those too as augmented reality spaces that you can walk through. Pentecostals, I think, popularized the word yes in Black church community. It's a word, yes, that's about surrender, openness. And so I've been thinking about the word yes, and one of the things Pentecostals do is chant the word yes and the phrase yes, Lord. Descend the scale, the word yes, and sometimes you sing the phrase yes, Lord, as well. But also, I've been trying to think about, is there a way for me to engage the practices that were deeply joyful to me when I inhabited Pentecostal spaces? I still love music, I listen to gospel primarily still, but I'm also an agnostic, and I'm like comfortably an agnostic. I'm not like, you know, it's not a cataclysm or crisis for me. I'm agnostic and it's cool. And but I still love like the energy of Pentecostalism, because in this weird way it actually taught me how to accept the fact of my queerness. And that's a long conversation that we can have one day. And so I've been trying to figure out, are there ways to actually inhabit the same kind of practices while not having to, like, you know, endure sermons that are deeply homophobic. And so I've been trying to think with a lot of the practices, and I've become obsessed with Steve Reich's Music for 18 Musicians. If you don't know it, it's a 55 or so minute song that was first recorded in 1976. It's 55 minutes long, it has 11 movements, it has 11 chords, and each of the movements moves through a chord cycle. Deeply repetitious, and it's described as shimmering. It is, for me, a deeply spiritual and also really, really Pentecostal song. And so, this is one of a sound from one of the movements. But in 2021, I was supposed to do a live performance of a project called Yes Lord, because one day I was driving in my car from Silver Spring, where my brother lived, back to Charlottesville, and I was listening to Music for 18 Musicians, and one of the movements came on, and I started singing the word yes, and I said, oh, that's the idea. And so I'd written about Music for 18 Musicians in my second book, but I didn't know that I was actually going to do this. It kind of had to happen the way that it did. And so what I did was I went through all of the movements of Music for 18 Musicians and I added the word yes, or the phrase yes, Lord, and the sound of a Hammond organ. It was supposed to be live in 2021, but because of the pandemic, we weren't able to do it. So we did a recorded version of it. And so this is from Movement 2. Orchestra, a Hammond organ, choir, and choreography. 2024. Don't got a budget. Don't got an orchestra. But we will be doing it. Like, I see it, so it's going to happen. There is a experimental artist named Christina McPhee, visual artist who also does film. I had been posting clips of this Yes Lord thing when I downloaded Pro Tools in 2019. And she listened to a bunch of them and said, I want to make a film with it. So she created this. It's 40 minutes. Not funny.
Yes, Lord.
one thing the singers found out was, I had known it because I had been doing it in my house in Pro Tools since December 2019, is that it actually is very, very, very difficult to sing the word yes or the phrase yes, Lord for 5 minutes at a time over and over again. It's one of the most difficult things that one can do. And for me, the song is about blackness, it's about queerness, because to live in a world that is constantly saying no to the, like, your very existence, to live in that world is to say yes. But to say yes is not like an easy disposition, it's not frivolous, it can be fun sometimes, but often it's not fun. It requires a lot to sustain the capacity of the yes. And so all the singers are like, $1,000 for singing for 55 minutes? Sure. And each one thought that they were gonna just do it the day before I turned in. I got email after email, can I have an extra week? Because each of them discovered, as they tried to do one of the movements, oh, this is actually difficult. And I really appreciated their learning that, because living the disposition of the yes is not an easy one, but it still has the capacity to be artful, it still has the capacity to be joyful, it still has the capacity to allow for literally the practice of connection to happen. And that for me is what spirituality is. And so thank you all for letting me go through some slides for today. Happy to answer.
Any questions for Ashon? We've got time for a couple.
Thank you so much. That was beautiful.
Thank you.
This is probably too big to answer, but what does connection mean to you?
What does?
Connection.
Well,
I can qualify it if it helps, but people are, I'll let you.
Well, you know, all matter vibrates, and so all matter is making sound. And for me, connection is the allowance or the accepting of the fact of our movement as that which produced the occasion for us to be in relation. So for me, connection is the recognition that we need one another. And not just connection with people. It's not a sort of anthropomorphic or anthropocentric. Humanocentric? I don't know. It's not about humans. It's about connection with all that is. Connection with earth, connection with sky, connection with, and with other creatures as well. And so really trying to figure out how can we be in relation with one another is for me what connection is. Connection is the being in relation. And that I think that there's so many different sort of ways that we learn from our schooling, for example, that we're supposed to be individual. But like the idea of the individual as the primary unit through which we should measure the world actually has done so much harm to the world in the last 500 years. More harm than has happened to it before because of this idea of like not needing to be connected. I can be fully disconnected from everything. Sign is disconnected too. And that, you know, you're trying to figure out how to be an individual, but that individuality actually is the thing that has produced so much harm, because connection, I think, is the thing that we are. It is the thing that we have. Our central nervous system is a discontinuous system, that our capacity to feel is because it is open-ended, and because it has to, like, sense outside of itself in order for things to actually be sensed. And for me, even our flesh then tells us that what we are these like connections. And that what we learn is that we are not supposed to be connected somehow. And it does so much harm. And so for me, connection is more, it's mostly like allowing the flesh to be what it is, and allowing imagination to be what it is, and allowing love and joy and presence to be what it is, which is the recognition that you ain't going alone.
Thank you.
Time for one more question.
Thanks for the presentation. I was wondering, I really like how you link together sort of like these Islamic practices mm-hmm. to like
right, things that are happening to people who were brought here to the States, because it's always this like mythology that like we just learned about religion, like this kind of stuff. But if you learned about Islam, you had to know about Christianity, you had to know about all these other things. I'm wondering, like, in all that as well, there was a lot of like practices that came over from like traditional African practices, and, like all like the synchronization and all that kind of stuff. I wonder if that makes it your way into like your research and stuff.
It, I mean, the African traditional practices have not yet. The complicated way to say it is that it has, insofar as I'm like trying to still practice Black Pentecostalism, which to me is not just the retention of, it is the deployment of African traditional practice, even though the doctrinal sort of understanding of those practices that they're sinful. It's like this weird thing where it's like the very thing that makes you possible is the thing that you are constantly renouncing, which is literally like what queerness is. It's what, there's so much in like the so-called New World that's about renouncing the very thing that you are. And so for me, on the one hand, those practices make their way into what I'm doing because the practices that I'm doing are literally only possible because of African traditional practices of voodoo or candomblé. And yet, I'm also trying to figure out ways not to do it myself, but to work with folk, to work with others who would want to do collaborative projects that are trying to think about these spiritualities together. Like, I'm not going to engage in Islamic practices myself, because it's not my tradition, but I do want to. So the musician for the Hammond organist that we use for the Yes Lord project is Abdul Hamid Robinson Royal, who was a musician for both of my Hammond organ curation show. And trying to do more of that kind of cross spiritual practice work too feels really, really important to me, because I think what we're trying to model is connection. And so allowing that work to be collaborative feels really important to me, because I'm not trying to take up the space of anybody else. I actually don't believe in conversion. It's a long, complicated reason why. Or actually, it's not long or complicated. Conversion causes violence. And I'm tired of violence. And, but like, that doesn't mean that you can't practice the thing that you want to practice. But the idea of conversion is a thing that I said to my brother last night. I think I have to write another book. He said, stop. but I think it's true. But like, I what I'm really interested in is, do we have the capacity in relation with one another across religious difference, and not in that kind of weird, let's do an interfaith service at a church, like, because that's like, well, that's not interfaith. It's like going to a church and telling other people y'all can come here, but really trying to think about what are our points of connection, and where are our points of difference that we don't have to let go of. Let's have our difference too. And let's celebrate the fact of our difference. And so trying to think about that with other people is one of the next stages of this project, certainly. So thank you.
All right, let's give Ashon one more round of applause.
Thank you.
Just truly wonderful to have you this morning, and thank you again. Just beautiful connection. And loved the presentation. Well, thanks to you all for coming. Thanks for being here. It is that time of morning to go back to the real world, and that's okay. We are okay with it because it's Friday. We're not okay with it? Okay. Not okay. Anyways, thanks again. See you. See you next time.
Coffee and donuts on your way out.
Yes, get coffee and donuts.